Why are we drawn to the cinema? And what is it about story that keeps us coming back to it? Join me as I take you on an odyssey through story, structure, character, and meaning. We will answer all these questions and more on Behind the Screenplay. In this episode, we are going to look at dramatic irony in American Gangster, the duality and contradictions in both protagonist and antagonist, and how a very effective plot device ties the two together. For those that haven't heard of him, Frank Lucas was the biggest heroin dealer in New York City from 1969 to 1975, and he is noteworthy because he was able to obtain heroin direct from a source in Thailand and transport high-quality dope back to the United States using military transport planes coming back from Vietnam. For the longest time, no one, not even the mafia, knew he was doing this or how he was doing it. He ran Harlem and built a mafia organization of his own, using his brothers as lieutenants. And it is estimated by 1975, when he was arrested and convicted, he had earned over $250 million in cash, which he saved in safe deposit boxes and foreign banks in the Cayman Islands. That's the equivalent of $1.1 billion today. Denzel Washington plays Frank Lucas in the movie, and his performance is a tour de force.
The loudest one in the room is the weakest one in the room, I told you that.
The role required something controlled, subdued. And while he does show fits of rage, those scenes don't exist for spectacle. He doesn't often take a role where he's forced to be evil, heartless, or a murderer or killer. Even Richie Roberts, the cop who is credited for eventually catching Lucas, says that the movie paints Lucas as almost noble. In this film, you want to see Frank succeed. You want to see him best his competitors. It is difficult to make a protagonist like Frank Lucas sympathetic to the audience, but Ridley Scott achieves this, and Denzel Washington delivers one of the finer performances of his long career. It's one of those rare things in cinema when you find a plot device that is so closely tied to the main character that it comes to define him. Citizen Kane is a good example of this, as the whole film is built around defining the plot device, and the identity of that device is not revealed until the very end. In other films, like No Country for Old Men, the plot device doesn't so much define the characters as it is an object of desire they fight over. In American Gangster, the plot device is a source of fortune for one character and a subject of investigation for the other. But there is also an emotional connection the antagonist has to the plot device, as the plot device, a blue magic baggie of heroin, is the thing that kills his partner, and this is truly unique in the screenplay. Richie Roberts, the antagonist cop played by Russell Crowe, he and his partner have become pariahs within the police department because they find $1 million in the trunk of a car, and Richie demands they must turn it in. Of course, no one will work with them after that, the idea being none of the other crooked cops can trust them. So Richie's partner can't work, gets strung out on heroin, and overdoses, and dies. When Richie comes to ID the body, there is a baggie of blue magic heroin at the morgue. Richie feels that he was responsible for his old partner's death and he must right this wrong by the end of the movie. In that way, he now plays both the antagonist to Denzel Washington's character Frank Lucas, and is the protagonist in his own story. He now has the desire, a good reason to solve the mystery of the blue magic heroin that killed his friend. The protagonist, Frank Lucas, has desires of his own. To be independent of the Italians, basically.
That would never happen with Italians. More important than any one man's life is order.
And Frank has been taught very well by his mentor, the deceased Harlem gangster Bumpy Johnson.
Right through the hair. Cutting out the supplier. The middleman. Buying direct. Putting Americans out of work.
And Frank sees an opportunity lurking in the disdain his old boss had for modern American business. So when Bumpy dies, Frank doesn't know what he's going to do, but Frank has still been buying his dope from the Italians in New York who are getting it from corrupt cops.
This is the French Connection dope. Kilos of the same dope Eddie Egan and Sonny Grasso took from us. The cops seize it, arrest everyone, and then they start taking it out of the evidence room, whacking it down to nothing and selling it back to us. They basically control the market with it.
At this point, it is estimated that one-third of American troops are experimenting with opium and heroin.
So Frank watches television about how soldiers are returning from Vietnam, addicted to heroin, and he decides to take off to Vietnam himself to check it out. And takes $400,000 in cash with him.
Be already chopped up. I want to go get it where they go get it from. I want to go to the source.
So he heads into the Golden Triangle to go get it from the source.
How would you get it into the States?
You ain't got to worry about that.
Who do you work for in there?
You ain't got to worry about that either.
And to this end, Frank achieves a desire that was emotionally tied to his mentor.
$50,000. It's going to cover them and the pilot and the boys on the other end.
Give them 100. Give them the whole thing. Yeah. So if that dope don't arrive for any reason.
And with this action, Frank has now achieved Bumpy's idea and has cut out the middlemen. Meanwhile, the U.S. attorney has made Richie the head of a heroin task force, but Richie continues to behave badly in his personal life. He's going through a child custody case, and it's easy to see why. He sleeps around with many different women. He makes excuses for not seeing his son. So the first major character irony becomes clear. The antagonist is an untouchable, ethical cop, but he's a serial philanderer and a deadbeat dad. Never does the dual ironies of both protagonist and antagonist become clearer than at the midpoint of the movie. And unlike Hoosiers, where the midpoint is spoken,
I don't know if it'll make any change, but I figure it's time for me to start playing ball.
Or Casino, where the midpoint is also spoken.
Let me tell you something, partner. You ain't home. But that's where we're gonna send you if it hair lips the governor.
The midpoint of American Gangster is expressed in an entirely visual way, with glad handing and photographs driving the rest of the story forward. And from this midpoint, we see the ironies build, making themselves fully known, adding a richness to the narrative that I have seen in very few films. At the midpoint climax of the movie, Richie tells his crew of cops that they are getting nowhere. The months of work they have endured has been fruitless. So they are going to start over. He is going to the boxing match by himself to watch the politics of it.
Same boxing, kid. It's politics.
And with a badge and a camera, he goes alone by himself to see all the gangsters fawn over Frank Lucas and pay their respects to some black guy in a chinchilla coat that he has never seen or heard of before. Richie, all by himself. Frank, surrounded by power. And of course, this opens the story up for Richie's investigative team.
Hey, his tickets were phenomenal. Better seats than Dominic Catano, right? Joe Louis shook his hand. Who the fuck is this guy?
And after the cops start following him and learning what they learn about Frank's life, the irony of Frank's character is fully revealed.
Everything about Frank's life seems unpretentious, oddly illegitimate.
And here we have the protagonist, a killer, a drug lord, living his life in a very similar and opposite way to the antagonist, Richie Roberts. Frank doesn't sleep around, he's loyal to his own family. He's vicious at work and will break every law he has to and kill whoever he has to, but he maintains the image of a very respectable man in his private life. Richie reveals Frank is his perfect opposite. The bad guy and the good guy are now an even match for each other, and totally, equally ironic in their balance of characterization. The protagonist being the real bad guy and the antagonist being the real good guy. The irony is pushed further when before the final act, Richie decides to let go of fighting his wife in the legal system over their son and just let her have him. And Frank, normally subdued and controlled, flips out that Vietnam is ending and his drug transportation will no longer be possible. And it's that last load of junk that Richie is able to track down and nail Frank on. And while Richie has been working all Sunday morning raiding the den of iniquity in the projects where Frank's people have been cutting and bagging, Frank has been sitting in church with his mother singing Amazing Grace when Richie shows up to arrest him. And then as they talk over coffee, Frank the gangster becomes the informant, and Richie the prosecutor becomes the defense attorney. In the director's cut, there is an additional scene at the conclusion of the film that adds to the irony with a sort of role reversal for Frank and Richie. Frank is getting out of prison, broke, wearing an old suit, and Richie is waiting there for him, in a news suit, standing beside a Beamer. When the story started, it was Richie that was broke and struggling, and it was Frank that was on his way up. Then Richie buys Frank a cup of latte and explains to him how it's a
fancy way of saying coffee with milk.
And how tennis shoes are
who's this? Expensive sneakers. About $100 a pair.
Richie has stepped into the future. Frank is still stuck in the past.
This was me, Richie, right here. This was all me. Back in my day, there was so many niggas out here buying dope, could have made a Tarzan movie.
Yeah, that vernacular wouldn't have played, even in the 1990s. And I can see why Universal cut this scene from the picture. Robert McKee says irony is the subtlest manifestation of story pleasure. That sense of feeling, yes, life is just like this. It plays with the paradox, aware of what seems and what is. Of McKee's six ironic story patterns, the following defines Frank Lucas, quote, "The action he takes to destroy something becomes exactly what is needed to be destroyed by it." At this point in the story, Frank is afraid of the Italians. He thinks they tried to kill him. He wants to crush them. And then the war in Vietnam begins to end. And he feels he has to make one last push, one last score to get enough dope to earn the cash needed to take on the Italians in an all-out war.
It's not in my best interest to say this, Frank. But quitting while you're ahead is not the same as quitting.
But in taking that action, it is the very way he destroys himself, because Richie is already on his tail. Richie's ironic story pattern is this. The protagonist is pushed further and further from his goal, only to find that he's been led right to it. For most of the movie, Richie's team investigates, follows, tracks, and gathers information. But they get absolutely nowhere, so he's pushed further and further from his goal, until he gets the idea to go to the boxing match, and eureka, he's led right to Frank. So even as arcs change within each character in the story, the screenplay excels at the ironic descent and ascent of the two main characters. In their dualistic natures, the main character being the bad guy, and being a killer and a dealer, but always taking his mother to church, always up at 5 a.m. There's one irony. And the other, the antagonist who is the good guy, but he cheats on his wife, he never sees his son, he fights her in court even though he doesn't have the time. But at work, you cannot buy this guy off. He's totally and completely moral and ethical in his work life. And in these two characters, you have the ironies of American Gangster. If you enjoyed this video, please follow the link in the description and leave me a tip on Patreon. How much do you ask?
$1.
$1. Fine. That's the way they want it? No problem.
$1 is not much, and it motivates me to make more of these. Don't forget to hit the like and subscribe button, as that really helps me out. And if you keep watching them, I'll keep making them. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you for the next episode of Behind the Screenplay.